In this fifth video in the Mythbusters series, we're going to look at the subject of women in leadership. And we need to look at the context and culture in which the scriptures were based. Because, like other Gentile churches and other Greek cities under Roman rule, the church at Ephesus was troubled by groups of men who taught error and who may also have been living immorally. Christians, and especially women, were harassed. They were living side by side with the occult in its various forms, and they were in need of real help. The tension in the city of Ephesus between Jews and Christians made life very difficult for the Christians, who were being pressured to compromise their loyalty to Jesus through persecution and marginalization. Roman law and Greek culture were very strong, and it took great resistance on the part of Christians not to be compromised and not to have their bold faith in Jesus diluted or even disabled. Now, the word for church leadership that Paul used in his letter to Timothy was episkopos. And the word episkopos was not a specifically Christian word, but it was used in the secular world to describe various kinds of responsible leadership, which were largely civic or financial. Episkopos is a hard word to faithfully translate it into English. Overseership might be the best literal rending. It described the work or position of an overseer in society. And in 1 Timothy 3:1, Paul defined the overseer in terms of function, not in terms of an office. So he said, "The saying is sure, whoever aspires to a bishop desires a noble task." Paul was not encouraging to see mere human status of an office, but rather to see divine responsibility of a calling. Whether that responsibility was also an office is open to debate, but we should certainly observe that no word corresponding to office accompanies episkopos in the Greek text here. But in whatever way that issue is decided, episkopos does describe a position of special responsibility and leadership under Christ, as the accompanying qualifications in Ephesians imply. In Acts 14:23, Paul and Barnabas appointed elders in each church that they had established thus far in their work. Acts 14:23 says this: "After Paul and Barnabas had appointed elders for them in each church, with prayer and fasting they entrusted them to the Lord in whom they had come to believe." And in Acts 20:17, those who Paul summoned for Ephesus were called elders. But in Acts 20:28, he said the Holy Spirit had made them overseers to shepherd the church. Acts 20:17 says, "From Miletus, Paul sent a message to Ephesus asking the elders of the church to meet him." But just a few verses later, he addresses them and said, "Keep watch over yourselves and over all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers." Therefore, overseers and elders refer to the same group of people in this particular context. When looking at the early chapters of Acts, we must also recognize the Jewishness of the Christians before the dispersion took place, when the Jewish believers were then scattered among Gentile churches. Elders were well known in Judaism from the time of Moses to Second Temple Judaism, and Paul based his new covenant leadership roles on the synagogue's leadership roles. Indeed, there is no passage in the New Covenant scriptures that radically differentiates the role of Christian elders from the Jewish elders, and they are even used together at times, as we will see later. In Titus 1, 5-7, Paul clearly refers to the same group as both elders and as overseers. He says this: "I left you behind in Crete for this very reason, so that you should put in order what remained to be done, and should appoint elders in every town as I directed you, for a bishop as God's steward must be blameless." It seems clear then that the overseers are the same people who, quote, from 1 Thessalonians 5:12, labour among you and have charge of you in the Lord and admonish you. Now, interpreters do not agree on whether the phrase married only once in 1 Timothy 3:2 and 12, if that expression by implication excluded women from leadership. It says this: a bishop must be above reproach, married only once, and let deacons be married only once. While this English expression, married only once, can be interpreted in different ways, and it is, its context and culture require it to mean that elders should not be married to more than one partner at the same time, therefore setting aside as unacceptable the very common practice of polygamy. Paul did not outlaw remarriage after a partner had died or was divorced, and such legalistic prohibitions have virtually no evidence in the scriptures to support them. Married only once certainly does not exclude women from being elders, and there is plenty of evidence of women elders, both Jewish and Christian, by the second century. Even some who hold that 1 Timothy 2:12 excludes women from authority over men think that eldership is open to women. Now, there was clearly a plurality of leadership within each house church and within a city, and there was a plurality of leadership bodies. There may have been three clearly defined groups, elders, overseers and deacons, but even if there were, the scriptures certainly point to those groups having overlapping functions. The overseer may have been an elder who had significant span of authority over a group of churches, and this model would directly reflect the role of some of the elders in the synagogues. The difficulty within any precise interpretation of leadership in the early church is that the leadership itself was constantly changing and adapting, because the church itself was constantly changing and thus often adapting its leadership model. It is noteworthy that when Paul lists several ministries in Ephesians 4, he does not assign the titles of overseer or elder to any of them, neither individually nor as a group. It says this: the gifts Christ gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. In Romans 12, 3-8 and 1 Corinthians 12, 28-30, various gifted ministries were named without indicating the utilization of these was the province of elders or overseers. And those passages included the ministries of the leader and the forms of leadership. So, in 1 Timothy 5:17, there seemed to be a variety of different functions among the elders. 1 Timothy 5:17 says this: let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honour, especially those who labour in preaching and teaching. Paul was therefore recognising a specialised ministry among the elders, with some of the elders, but not all of them, concentrating on teaching and preaching. We must now move on to examine in some depth the very controversial verse of 1 Timothy 2:12. In the NRSV it says, I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She is to keep silent. Well, the NIV says, I do not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She must be silent. So, let us now carefully examine 1 Timothy 2:12 from the Greek and not just build theologies from one English translation. This verse has probably received more attention in recent years than any other passage of similar length. It has been explored and certainly exploited by some of those concerned with gender roles in the church, and the approaches have been as varied as the concerns. Yet, this one New Covenant scripture, 1 Timothy 2:12, stands over and against the rest of the New Covenant scriptures, and yet it has had a theological house of cards built upon it. Do the New Covenant scriptures see women as gifted by Yahweh?
Yes.
Do the New Covenant scriptures see women as being enabled by the Holy Spirit of Yahweh?
Yes.
Do the New Covenant scriptures see women as being called to minister under Yahweh without human limitations?
Yes.
This discussion involving these questions has raged for a long time, and there seems to be no end in sight. But what has often been overlooked in much of the discussion is the fact that 1 Timothy 2:12 contains no command. There is no imperative addressed to Timothy in 1 Timothy 2:12, nor is there any command to the woman, nor is there any command to the churches about women teaching or having authority. I will say it again as plainly as I can. 1 Timothy 2:12 contains no command imperatives. Yet, English translations almost always adopt an imperative where there isn't one. And that is a very common error in translation. We also need to realise that there are many problems of translation associated with correctly interpreting 1 Timothy 2:12. To begin with, what is translated as "I do not permit" in the NIV or "I permit no" in the NRSV is in the present imperfect tense in the Greek, which makes a total and timeless ban on women teaching absolutely impossible from the text. Therefore, it should be translated as "I am not currently permitting," which is a quite different meaning to a total ban. Furthermore, why did Paul use the indicative form instead of making it a command prohibition by using an imperative? It is wholly reasonable to interpret Paul as only making a temporary practice that was not permanently binding. Furthermore, in the Greek, the "a," as in "a woman" and "a man," is not only a singular pronoun, thus ruling out a ban on all women, but it is also a singular, specific pronoun. In other words, Paul was referring here to one specific woman that he did not currently allow to teach or to have authority over one specific man. Paul did not name this woman because he had no need to do so. Timothy knew perfectly well who Paul was writing about. Therefore, Paul was actually saying, "I am not currently permitting this one specific woman to teach or to have authority over this one specific man." Paul was not banning any other woman from teaching, and even the ban on this one specific woman was only temporary. It is also unclear what Paul meant by "teach," because he did not define what he meant by the word. Also, to add to the difficulty, the Greek word translated as "to have authority" is not at all clear in its meaning. The Greek verb that Paul used for authority is authentio, and this verb and its related forms are very rare in Greek literature. And that word only appears here this once in the whole of the New Covenant scriptures. And what is sometimes overlooked in discussions on the meaning of authentio is that Paul chose this very rare verb for authority over the normal verb exousiazo, which is the common word relating to authority. In 1 Timothy 2:12, we must ask why, if Paul was writing about authority in the usual sense, he chose to use a most unusual and very rare Greek word that had a history of very strong meanings. It should also be noted that the clause in verse 12 specifically limits its prohibition to one particular woman teaching and having authority over one particular man. So what does all this mean? I believe that Paul was writing here in the specific context of marriage, and that he was referring to that one woman's own husband, and therefore Paul did not in any way rule out ministry for women as a whole. If, as I believe, this verse relates exclusively to the marriage covenant between that woman and that one man, This verse is about marriage headship. It is not about church leadership. In any event, 1 Timothy 2:12 cannot with any integrity be used as a blanket ban on women engaging ministry of any kind, because the Greek text itself simply does not allow that incorrect interpretation. The NRSV translation of 1 Timothy 2:12 is misleading and does not faithfully translate the Greek. There is no legitimate way to believe from 1 Timothy 2:11 to 15 that Paul prohibited women from either teaching men or to have any kind of authority over men in leadership and ministry. Thus, any attempt to apply this verse in that way in a Western or other contemporary culture is both futile and incorrect. I state clearly my own belief from the evidence that Paul's statement was directed to specific circumstances in relation to only one woman and one man in one particular marriage relationship to Ephesus and in the Ephesian church. Why do I say that? Because Paul never mentioned it again anywhere else in his writings. If Paul had meant to command a complete ban on women teaching and leading, he would certainly have mentioned it elsewhere in his letters as an imperative command, but he didn't. In fact, the opposite is true. Paul clearly and unmistakably showed women in teaching and leadership positions, including apostles. Therefore, it is both wrong and incredibly foolish to apply 1 Timothy 2:12 as a blanket ban on women in leadership, and to do so is to apply the scripture without integrity. Now, let's explore further scriptures that make clear just how much women were involved in Christian life and ministry generally in Paul's day, and in Paul's own travelling company too. Philippians 4 verses 2 and 3 say this: I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Now, in his own culture and in his own time, when Paul wrote of co-workers in this way, he made the co-workers equal to himself. Paul was an apostle. Therefore, his co-workers were also apostles too. That is the clear cultural and contextual implication of what Paul wrote. Euodia and Syntyche were apostles alongside Paul. They were female apostles. Furthermore, each house church in those days was led by that house church's host. For example, in Colossians 4:15, Paul spoke of Nympha and the church that met in her house. This is what he wrote: Give my greetings to the brothers and sisters in Laodicea, and to Nympha and the church in her house. Nympha was a female church leader, and she was a church leader because that is the role that she was fulfilling. We know that Nympha was the leader of that house church because it was in her house. In the closing greetings in his letter to the church at Rome, Paul wrote of his relatives who had been in prison and who were also apostles alongside him. He wrote this in Romans 16:7: Greet Andronicus and Junia, my relatives who were in prison with me. They are prominent among the apostles, and they were in Christ before I was. Junia, named here as an apostle, is female. Although there have been a great many arguments and heated discussions about the gender of this name, a female apostle is the only meaningful conclusion that ultimately has any real integrity from the scripture. To argue that Paul speaks here about two male apostles who were named in the Greek text in this way is an argument that stands on no meaningful foundation. Furthermore, the New Covenant scriptures name prophetesses who were ministering at that time. For example, Philip the Evangelist had four unmarried daughters who were greatly used in prophecy, Acts 21 verse 8. The next day we left and came to Caesarea, and we went into the house of Philip the Evangelist, one of the seven, and stayed with him. He had four unmarried daughters who had the gift of prophecy. Prophecy can be very powerful in its impact, and females are used in this way by Yahweh just as much as males. Prophetesses also ministered in leadership, and Peter enlarged upon this. He wrote in 2 Peter chapter 1, "First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God." The Greek word that is often translated here only as men in some interpretations, moved by the Holy Spirit, is not gender specific, and it is a matter of integrity to translate it as men and women because it clearly covers both. The NRSV translation correctly speaks of men and women because it meant any man and any woman who was moved by the Holy Spirit. Men and women alike were moved by the Holy Spirit, and men and women alike spoke from Yahweh. This is true equality under Yahweh, and no one is excluded. Men and women are certainly different, but they are just as certainly equal under Yahweh. Now, let's explore in some more depth this passage from Romans 16, verses 1 to 6. It says this: "I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a deacon of the church at Centria, so that you may welcome her in the Lord as is fitting for the saints, and help her in whatever she may require from you. For she has been a benefactor of many, and of myself as well. Greet Prisca and Aquila, who work with me in Christ Jesus, and who risk their necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Greet also the church in their house. Greet my beloved Epaphroditus, who was the first convert in Asia for Christ. Greet Mary, who has worked very hard among you. Greet Andronicus and Junia, my relatives who were in prison with me. They are prominent among the apostles, and they were in Christ before I was. Greet Ampliatus, my beloved in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, our co-worker in Christ, and my beloved Stachys. Greet Apelles, who is approved in Christ. Greet those who belong to the family of Aristobulus. Greet my relative Herodian. Greet those in the Lord who belong to the family of Narcissus. Greet those workers in the Lord, Tryphena and Tryphosa. Greet the beloved Persis, who has worked hard in the Lord. Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and greet his mother, a mother to me also. Greet Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermes, Patrobus, Hermas, and the brothers and sisters who are with them. Greet Philologus, Julia, Nereus, and his sister in Olympus, and all the saints who are with them. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ greet you." Now, this closing section of Romans is very unusual in Paul's writings. It is not at all typical of what he wrote. The high number of greetings that Paul sent in this final section is very unusual. It comprised 26 individuals, two families, and three house churches. It may initially be surprising that Paul sent greetings about so many people in Rome, given that Paul had never been to Rome himself, and that it would be around 3 years before he personally got to Rome. But letters of commendation were important in the ancient world. People who travelled in those days did so without the public facilities that we enjoy today, such as hotels and restaurants and coffee shops, and so they relied on the hospitality of people that they had never met as they had moved around. Phoebe was going to be travelling to Rome herself, and she was commended by Paul as both a sister, and the Greek word is Adelphi, a term very rare in the New Covenant scriptures, but she was also an official servant, diakonos, of the church in Centria, and she was also a benefactor, prostatis, to many people. This meant that she was a successful and wealthy businesswoman who used her wealth to support the church and its leaders like Paul. Prisca and Aquila were a well-known couple who were tent makers like Paul and who had fled from Rome because of Claudius's expulsion order and who had gone to Corinth. They ministered alongside Paul in Corinth and then went to Ephesus where they engaged in ministry and brought Apollos to a deeper experience of faith. They served with Paul in Ephesus for some time before returning to Rome after Claudius's edict lapsed. Prisca and Aquila were commended as fellow workers, a term Paul used frequently to describe people who ministered alongside him and who were regarded by Paul as equal to himself. Paul also recorded that they risked their own lives for Paul, probably during the riot in Ephesus. Prisca and Aquila owned a house large enough to be used as a house church, and they must have been fairly wealthy. Mary was a common Jewish name, and it was also used by Gentiles, so we cannot be sure of her ethnic background, but Paul commended her for working very hard among the Christians at Rome. Andronicus and Junia were relatives of Paul and had been in prison with Paul. They were Christians before he was, and Paul says that they are prominent among the apostles. Andronicus and Junia were almost certainly husband and wife, and Paul called both of them apostles. It is very hard to manipulate the Greek text in such a way that avoids the conclusion that there were female apostles, prophetesses, and leaders in Paul's day. Indeed, of the 26 Christians commended by Paul in this short section of Romans, 10 were women. So, in conclusion, women were a very important and very public part of the Christian community in Rome and elsewhere. Women were also a very important, very public part of the leadership of the Christian community in Rome and elsewhere. What we do with all of this in our context and our time is entirely another matter. But let us be very careful not to make rules and regulations from just one English translation. That is a very bad mistake to make, but it is a mistake that is frequently made. Let us also be very careful not to preach and teach from one English translation without referencing the Greek text. To be taken seriously in academic and scholarly circles, use only the NRSV translation and do not, under any circumstances, use a translation or a paraphrase that says what you want to say. Also, and finally, let us be very careful not to make what Paul said about one situation a rule for all situations. I close by saying that women are equal before God. Women are equal with men before God. There is no difference in how Yahweh will use men or women, and it is time for the church to recognize that, to acknowledge it, and to act upon it.